last month. This is my son Hayden Trigg. He is 8 years old. He is a charmer of the ladies, as you can see here.
Yes, I
am. And he's humble and modest. He's also got a big football ego. He is a member of the Texas High School state champion football team, Lake Travis High School. He's also accompanied by his full-time, awesome UT master's graduate nurse, Neil. Ooh. And his mother, me, Adrian. So that's our first slide. I will have this recorded in this session, and we're going to put it on his blog, so if anyone's not here that you want to pass this on to, they can watch it there as well. So this past year has provided us with the opportunity for a lot more public speaking than I've ever imagined on healthcare. We testified in the Senate, the House, the Texas State Department of Health and Human Services, on local TV networks and live national platforms. And it's an honor to be asked to speak here by Dr. Faulkner today. You'll see this just started our advocacy at the Capitol and where we were pretty much all last session. And that's where we were picked up by MSNBC. And after testifying quite a few times, they asked us to speak on some of the healthcare bills that were being proposed. I'll have question and answer at the end of the session, so if there's anything that comes up along the way, I'll be happy to answer your questions. This is also my introduction to public health on problems and successes in obtaining information on healthcare. This picture is a visual analogy of the path that I currently feel that I'm on. It is not unlike my agricultural upbringing. When I look at this picture, it is a remote landscape. The road is not well defined. It is rocky and uncertain. The environment requires a lot of manual labor and hard work. While continuing on this road, one will certainly face steep challenges at times, but can find beauty all along the way if they but turn their attention to the majesty of those surroundings. So what I'm here to talk to you first is, as I mentioned, October is Spina Bifida Awareness Month, but what is Spina Bifida and what causes it? The Spina Bifida Association has a National Resource Center, and that's an 800 number that you can reach out to them. They have websites and they have various support groups throughout the country. Spina Bifida is a general term used to describe a variety of different neural tube defects, meaning split spine in Latin. Spina bifida is caused by a complex interaction of both genetic and environmental influences that ultimately affect any given pregnancy. The genetic influences remain poorly understood other than the commonalities of the MTFR gene, which has been recently discovered, maternal obesity, as well as people of Irish and Hispanic descent. So the environmental influences have been identified, such as the lack of folate intake in diet and absorption, the use of seizure medications during pregnancy, and the 20-year research study done by Dr. Faulkner was one of the most recent about fumonisin and mold spores on corn that have been identified for environmental influences. A mother had gone to the CDC, and she is the one that was responsible for getting folate being put into fortified cereals and flours, because they identified that as one of the reasons that spina bifida was popping up. So in the US, we're one of the very few countries that has developed that requirement for our flours. The CDC recommends that all women take 4 milligrams of folic acid at least 1 month prior to conception, as spina bifida and neural tube defects occur prior to the woman missing her first period and before she even knows she's pregnant. Unfortunately, even if all women did this, 30% of neural tube defect cases would still occur. Hayden, besides being handsome, was a perfectly strong, healthy embryo, and he developed spina bifida prior to becoming a fetus. Hayden has more than 26 diagnoses. I really stopped counting. I had to list them all out, and I said those were the major ones. Most are secondary to his primary diagnosis of spina bifida. But what does spina bifida look like? So I love this laser pointer my husband gave me. This is a slide that I was given from the Spina Bifida Texas Association. They're in San Antonio, and they educate the community in San Antonio, because I had mentioned there are environmental factors. There's the Hispanic population, and one of the other things is with obesity, so they have a larger Hispanic population in San Antonio, and they have quite a few families there with spina bifida. And they're educating about the neural tube. So that's what you're seeing here. Is these are approximations in days, but they definitely give you a good visual. At 21 days, that's a neural tube defect where the spine is closing and the head is left. And by 28 days, you'll see that that is identified, very distinguishable in the neural tube at 28 days. And that is often before anyone even knows that they're pregnant, that that has already occurred. So that's why they're saying to take your vitamins prior to conception. And then these are three types of spina bifida. Spina bifida occulta is the most common, and most people don't even know that they have it. You get diagnosed by a chiropractor because you have back problems. And what that would look like is there just might be a dimple in your sacrum, and that there's really no lasting effects. Then maybe you just were at a chiropractor and your back hurt for some reason. So that can be diagnosed there. Meningocele is where the cerebral fluid creates a bubble, and that's outside of the body, but the nerves are really undamaged. So that can be corrected. There, for some people, that they may have some nerve damage, some incontinence issues, or things of that nature. But Hayden was the big winner in this lottery, and he got myelomeningocele. And what that is you'll see all of these nerve endings are really displaced and can get damaged. They were on the outside of his body, and when you're in the womb, those nerves are rubbing up against amniotic fluid, rubbing up against the wall of the uterus, and those can get quite damaged in the womb before they're even born. And so I'll show you what that looks like. Good thing this is before lunch. The first picture is a study that we were a part of. These are all our personal pictures. This is not Hayden, but this was the first fetal surgery in the United States. This little boy named is Samuel. And Samuel, that's his womb. We call this twice born. And Samuel was reaching out and grabbing the doctor's hand at this time. What they do is they take the womb out, they rotate the child around, they operate on their back, they put them back in the womb, and they close them up. The womb actually heals that spine, and most of those children are without any sort of damage. So it's pretty amazing what has taken place there. Hayden, we went to San Francisco for this study. It was a study at the time. And we went to San Francisco, one of the only places in the country that was performing it. And we were not randomized to participate in this surgery. So we came back to Austin, and we had the surgery done afterward. So this is a picture of Hayden with his spina bifida, all that nakedness showing from his baby, but that's what the spina bifida lesion looks like. So his spine is on the outside of his body. We were lucky that there was still some skin intact, so his nerves weren't raw and exposed at that point, but there's still the rubbing. So I got to have a really big C-section to protect that part. And this is the day he was born. I didn't get to touch him, but there's a covering right there on his spine, and he was transported by ambulance to the new Dell Children's Hospital. So it was a pretty brand new hospital right when he was born. And this is within 24 hours, they closed up that lesion, put his spine back in his body, and he went on to be the healthy, happy kid he is now. But I wanted to tell you a little bit about my background when this was happening. So I find a large part of my identity is being a very responsible person in my life. I graduated from my undergrad in 4 years. I got my MBA with honors. I worked a decade growing my career in finance and real estate development when I moved here and met Marilyn. And I got married, and after my second child was conceived, Hayden was conceived as a healthy embryo via in vitro fertilization. I was taking all my medicines and all my vitamins, according to what the doctors had told me. I still ended up with a shocking diagnosis that changed my life forever. And oddly enough, this diagnosis occurred in October, so the same time during spina bifida. regardless of age, race, education, or socioeconomic standing. So it can happen to anyone at any time. And so the next slide is, what problems have you encountered in obtaining information on healthcare? So as I went in and found out at 20 weeks when I was just trying to get the diagnosis of was he going to be a boy or a girl, I got his diagnosis that he has spina bifida and my life was changed. I was suddenly drinking from a fire hose. I have no background in healthcare. I don't understand the language. So that was a big obstacle for me. The other obstacles that happen with everyone in this, and I'm trying to generalize this just besides my own personal background, but there is a stigma, and there's a cultural stigma at times, fear and blame when you first get a diagnosis, and maybe as you're ongoing. And caregivers are given very little support. Finding the answer to why the diagnosis happened is something that continues to go on for me, and that's where I was researching and learning about Dr. Faulkner's research on corn. I kept going, was I eating corn at day 14 when he was conceived? I have no idea. Still trying to learn that. And finding timely answers on what can be done to make the diagnosis achieve the best outcome and how to prevent it from happening again. There are socioeconomic barriers for quite a few people that can't get health care prior to learning their pregnancy or maybe through their pregnancy. So there's some of those barriers on how to get it to not happen again. Hayden is my middle child, so I've gone on to have another after him. And that was a very big concern of mine, is how to prevent this from happening to another child of mine. And those timely answers on what can be done to make it better is something that I'm looking to learn every day. So this next picture is just a support group. The first time I went to a national conference in California, these people I had known for 5 years, some through support groups that we had done online. And so it was so exciting to meet these rare families as we came to a national convention. But what were some of the problems that I encountered on finding them? And I spelled HIPAA wrong, I just want to point that out, is it's H-I-P-A-A. But HIPAA privacy laws kept doctors from referring us to other supportive families. So when this diagnosis happened, I had no one to turn to. It was very, very difficult to find them. We didn't have a lot of technology or online support other than forums, and I had to search people out. So that was a very difficult thing. And then there was no treatment for diagnosis. In some of his rare cases, we're part of the Undiagnosed Network out of Harvard, and we applied for Harvard Medical School, and we're still waiting for our acceptance, because they'll dedicate researchers to maybe find an interest to take up some of his uncharted treatments, you know, for his diagnoses. And there are no studies or clinical trials in the U.S. currently that benefit us. At the time when he was born, there was the big study, which was the MOM study, which was the in utero surgery. And it is a National Institute of Health sponsored clinical trial that began in 2002 and ended in 2009. So it was 7 years that was studying the best treatment for these children. What they had done is they had repaired lambs in utero, and the lambs were perfectly fine. They never had an issue after their birth. And so they wanted to do this for fetuses in the U.S. And so it took quite a while to recruit. 7 years, they only got 160 participants because you had to move to one of the centers, which was Vanderbilt or San Francisco. It was quite disruptive. But the clinical trials resulted showed prenatal surgery significantly reduced the need for a brain shunt. The fluid away from it, they didn't need to have the fluid taken away from the brain, and improved motor function, and increased the likelihood that the child could walk unassisted. So it was quite a positive trial that they ended it a year early, and this is now done throughout the United States in very select, very progressive children's hospitals that have teams to handle this. What were the causes to access problems? As I had mentioned, diagnosis, what is an access problem? Lack of medical terminology. I had no idea what they were saying most of the time. So that was really difficult to access, because I didn't even know when they were telling me, here's a diagnosis. I didn't understand the words, myelomeningocele. I couldn't say it. I couldn't research it. I had to learn. Anytime that had been mentioned in any of his records, I had to Google search everything, became my friend, or Wikipedia. Some of his diagnosis, myelomeningocele, I think that's over 13 letters, Arnold Chiari, hydrocephalus, bilateral strabismus, scoliosis. Those were some of the words I got to learn about. A few years ago, a few generations ago, the greatest obstacle to medical treatment was the lack thereof for treatment. Brain shunts like Hayden's were only started in the 50s, so life expectancy has only reached into the 70s thus far. So people really don't know what prognosis is, and I get that question a lot. Today, the psychiatric stigma of involuntary medical conditions is still regarded as a mark of shame. So stigma is a big one, and that is something that why we advocate, because stigma is such a big one. There's a mark of shame, it's a scarlet letter, something that we caused by carelessness. And we carry fear and blame, and we're looking to say, why did this happen? So caregivers are given very little support. Finding the answers to why this happened, finding the answers on how I can prevent it from happening, and finding timely answers again on what can I do to make it better. So most of us are given the same supports. This picture, I guess, is very hard to see, but there's a child in a wheelchair with a block right next to him, and they're all trying to access a view to the baseball game. So we're given the same supports, but it's not beneficial to everyone. And so it just shows that some, when you give them more support, when the adult gives the child two blocks and you give this nice ramp to the person in the wheelchair, some require more supports than others to get the same access as everyone else. And that's just a great visual, I think, to look at, to think about what are access problems. Well, most of us are over here and we can all see over the fence. It's really hard to think of those that need, and why do they need so much more? I also wanted to back up and say, why do they need so much more? Why do they need so much more for these caregivers? I had posed the question to a few friends in our community groups, what is their biggest thing that they want you to know about? Is frequent medical trips causes great financial burdens on all of our families. There's huge stresses, not only because of the medical issues that are happening to the ones that you care for, but the financial burdens of possible loss of job because you're taking and going and rushing off to medical emergencies. That most of the marriages, the percentage of divorce is over 80%, so there's big burdens with this. And then families in rural communities often end up being life-flighted or have to move closer to children's hospitals for access. Where I showed you, I grew up in a rural community in Montana, and we have a counterpart there that's the only one in the country that I know of that is most similar to Hayden. And when anything ever happens to him, they have a children's hospital there, but they don't have access to the quality and of subspecialists. So they actually have to get life-flighted to Seattle for care. And that's really not doable for a lot of these families. So they end up moving their careers, moving to be wherever the medical community is. And so I said HIPAA is one of the things that has been an access problem. So doctors have not been able to refer. There's no diagnosis in rare cases, so we need more funded research by the Undiagnosed Network. We need more research studies. We need more brilliant minds that are passionate about doing these research for the long-term individuals that are living with this. The FDA, what we found is the FDA has been very slow in allowing some of the treatments for stem cell treatment. We had gone to Mexico for it. It's now being done at Duke. And we found that there's been no scientist collaboration. I got to know quite a few of these researchers from the national studies that we're in, and I'm usually researching them out, and then I'll find one is studying something here in New York, and one's studying something here in California, and I'll say, do you know about each other? And they'll say, no, but we're very interested in collaborating. And then travel is also another access problem. We had to up and move to San Francisco within a matter of weeks. My husband had to leave his job, we had to leave our family, figure out our house, and move there for 3 months. We've had to move to Baltimore for 3 months for access to healthcare for Johns Hopkins, for a specialty program there. The other access problem was qualifying for Medicaid. There's a lot of red tape for qualifying for Medicaid. We had to stay in a nursing home after he was discharged from the hospital, so we took our young family, stayed overnight in a nursing home, and not overnight, it was longer than that, but we had to stay in a nursing home to receive and get the qualified round-the-clock care that he needed. And there's denials from insurance with pre-existing conditions. And some of the problems there with those access problems, the main problem is bad legislation. That's really where it starts. And it starts with bad legislation from lobbyists and for-profit insurance companies. And lastly, we have lots of problems. I just named 12 because I don't want to overwhelm anyone. But access to specialists with layers of staff. Dell was a brand new hospital. We had direct access with our specialists, and that was really great for us. But now as it's growing and UT has their medical school, there's now more layers. So for complex cases, it's harder for us to access who we need to. There's nurses, nurse practitioners, physicians, assistants, and residents before we even get to our doctor. And some of the things that I wanted to also mention is really the big one that we've been working on this last session, in number 11, has been insurance with pre-existing conditions. We have worked at the Capitol in Texas right now. They did a huge cut for Medicaid. In Texas, there's over 170,000 kids that are on a wait list for Medicaid. We were able to bypass our wait list. We're still number 12,000, and he's 8 years old. We've been on that wait list for 8 years. We were able to bypass our wait list by going straight into a nursing home because he was so acute in his care, and cute. But this legislation for the $350 million in cuts was done by Jay Nelson the last session. And so those $350 million in cuts was devastating for those that were already on it, but now 170,000 kids are on a wait list that can't access it. Only for the next 2 years, because legislation won't reconvene for 2 years, the budget's been cut, so they're not able to grow it. They're only able to add, in the whole state of Texas, less than 800 children to Medicaid. And CHIP, now at a federal level, has not been renewed, so we're not sure how CHIP is going to affect the state of Texas and what they're going to do legislatively. So there are some real access problems. And what are the recommendations to overcome these problems? The hardest thing for me, and I think for a lot of families is our pride, is to ask for help. And this is a picture. I don't know if any of you are familiar with this. Is anyone? So this is Morgan's Wonderland. And this was a parent in San Antonio, a very wealthy parent, that donated $53 million of his own funds to start an amusement park in San Antonio. It's the first of its kind in the whole world. It is amazing. It costs $10. It's all volunteer run. It's like Disneyland. And it's really for anyone 10 years and under. They have a whole water park. It's a huge, wonderful amusement park. And this was our spina bifida day. So we have an annual convention that meets down there. And that was just a really great time. So we ask for help. We find a lot of support groups wherever we can throughout the country. This just happens to be one of ours locally. The first thing to do when you ask for help is really to find, the best thing for us was finding a good hospital social worker. That was what saved our lives. Child life specialists and advocates in the community. And now technology is bringing us closer together with these rare birth defects and rare diagnoses. And then faith, I said, know your rights also. Seek secondary insurance. Medicaid has saved us from complete financial bankruptcy. We have primary insurance that is very good, that I've never had an issue with until we started having humongous bills. And to know your rights, disability is protected under the law. So some people might think that that's a bad word to say, this person's disabled. It's absolutely a PC correct term because it's protected under the law. And then realize that there are no other advocates better than you. My mom used to ask me when we were going through all these, well, is there an advocate at the hospital? Is there an advocate that can help you? And there isn't. We're our own best advocate. If you ever have a health need or a health problem, no one knows what's happening better than you do. So you really have to step up and be bold and advocate for yourself. Faith, in my mind, defeats fear. They come from two different energy levels. And when you get this, there's no chance that you're not going to be fearful whenever you have a new diagnosis. But really to just have cafe that you can reach out and have someone to rely on. It's led me to doctors and scientists, and they may not have been in my backyard, but it's led me to those that can help. I've asked for phone numbers. I have personal cell phones for our neurosurgeons, our urologists. I have their personal cell phones. I've turned to support groups so that we know that we're not in it alone. And some of those support groups, as I mentioned, are all over the country. There's a group outside of the U.S. as well. And when you're aware, the community of support is small, technology will connect you, and you can go to annual conferences and meet these people, and it's really great. What are the recommendations to overcome these problems? So this picture is Hayden's two neurosurgeons. He had Dr. George was actually why Delta Children's Hospital was built. He came out from Duke and was just brilliant, and Dr. Lee was another neurosurgeon, and they worked collaboratively together. So I say good doctors collaborate and don't have an ego. You may want more opinions on how to go about a non-standard medical issue. And really good doctors want you to do what's best for your situation. And if they feel that they're giving you good advice, they'll say to go get other advice so that you feel more comfortable with what they're recommending. And this is a picture of Dell's first and Seton Hospitals. He was a poster child for all of Seton's seven hospitals. Shortly after he was born, because they did a coordinated care conference that reduced, it's their goal for these coordinated care, you might hear of maternal mortality, easy for me to say, and it reduced anxiety for better outcomes with anticipation of what to expect. You saw that when he was born, he was transferred away by ambulance, so I didn't get to see him for 5 days. That was stressful enough, but I knew what to anticipate, and so I was able to recover from a huge C-section. Where I was cut hip to hip so that his spine would be not fixed or would be protected. I knew that I had to recover and that he had to recover from brain and spine surgery. So we had this very in-depth care conference that really helped reduce all of that stress with anticipation. And doctors, they help you get stable, they help you get through all that, but they don't tell you how to live day to day. So they get you living. They don't tell you how to live your life, but they get you alive and they keep you living. So how do you implement the recommendations? Practice being bold. This is another support group that we have that's just here in Austin. It's called CC4C. And they partner with any of these children with rare complex medical diagnoses. They partner them with their champion. And they have a celebrity champion. Hayden happens to be a celebrity champion that is a guitarist, a world famous guitarist. So he has a real rock star, and then Hayden gets to pick his high school that he would attend in his district and pick any sport that he'd like to be an honorary member of. And he just happened to last year pick the Lake Travis football team, so he got to go and be an honorary member and won the state championship ring that he's very proud of and will invite you all over to see anytime you want. We'll also have to learn how to do research, and that's where Dr. Faulkner was so humble. As I was researching how and why in my research, I came across her study, and I researched, who are these doctors, who are doing these studies, who are these scientists, and I saw M. Faulkner. I said, I think this is Dr. Faulkner, I know her. And it was so exciting to me to learn that. And to try to be humble in my learning, I reached out and I asked for help, and I got invited to the World Congress on Neural Tube Defects by Dr. Finnell, who's the head geneticist at UT. And while I didn't know anything that they were talking about, being the first time that they'd ever invited a non-scientist from around the world that's not presenting, I tried to gather the knowledge and make introductions to those scientists that are doing the forefront of the research for things that we would need and that affect our community. I get crisis counseling. Hayden has been through 22 surgeries in his 8 years of life that have been pretty gruesome. So we want to learn about that, and I know that other families, and that's one way to implement this, is nearly all caregivers are traumatized at some point and often diagnosed with chronic traumatic stress disorder. It isn't going away, and we want to not only cope, but we want to be happy. So maintaining a healthy lifestyle is the other thing, is when you're in the hospital, one of the things that you do is you really can't leave, and you're eating hospital food, so it's not great, and there's... when you're turning to coping, sometimes food is that. For me, it was running away, literally. And so I started running for my coping mechanism and running marathons and trying to raise awareness about spina bifida, but others also have, I've known that it's taken a negative turn where they've had to cope and they've turned to substances. So I know that there's different ways that people cope. But what I want to say is education and advocacy has been some of the best things across the street over at UT. These are the pioneers that went before us, and we're so grateful for them. They had this in the rotunda at the Capitol, and it was the UT Arlington campus and what they've done for those with disabilities and some of the support groups that they have there. And I'm so grateful for these pioneers. What I wanted to show you there is back in the 60s, most children were institutionalized or educated at home. And this was at a time of scoliosis, or no, I'm sorry, not scoliosis, polio. My grandfather had polio. So this is in the 60s, and this wheelchair-bound child, who was 9 years old, Sam, he could no longer access public schools, and the teacher had to come teach him at his house because they didn't allow kids in wheelchairs to be in school that required complex medical care. And had our nurse Neil not been with Hayden, Hayden would still today be probably most likely educated at home if he didn't have the nursing care that he has so that he can participate in school. And this other picture right here of this great pioneer, I want to read this story to you. He's paralyzed due to polio at age 5, Joseph Rowe, used his feet to paint pictures and build rockets in his garage. Although he dreamed of majoring in engineering or physics at UTA, a panel of deans told him that he was too dangerous to allow in science labs. Rowe graduated from UTA in the 70s as the first business major with a 4.0 GPA. So disability doesn't mean that you are